Now, we're going to begin our demo now. So we'll switch to the VirtualBox appliance here. Okay. I've effectively installed the box, connected to it on the system console, and switched it on. And it's booted. And if you watch carefully, you'll probably see that it is, in fact, really a Solaris system. And it's waiting for me to begin configuration. So press any key to start. Okay, and I have to fill in a basic configuration here, as you can see. The reason that the configuration already exists is because the system uses the dynamic host configuration protocol to go off and get network details, which I want to change to be static. So I'm going to change the host name. The system actually has a very useful command line interface, as well as a nice browser-based interface. And although most of the rest of the demo will be via the browser, I will hopefully spend a minute or two showing you commands that I can use from the command line as well. In fact, you can even do scripting if you're doing lots of repetitive commands each day. Just like any computer system, you can create scripts and have them executed. Okay. So all the other details here are okay. I'll enter a password and then escape one, which tells the system I've finished entering the configuration data. There we go. The system's come back to me now, and it's telling me that I should talk to the appliance on the network address I've assigned, and then port number 215. I could log in here on the console, and I could do things through the command line, but it's a bit nicer to show it through the basic user interface. Certainly the early stages of the configuration are also a little bit easier doing that. So I'll start up a web browser, and I'll go into the interface, which my system rightfully doesn't trust. So I'll proceed anyway. And there we go, I'm connected up to the storage appliance. Okay. Log in as root. Give the password. The system realizes that this is the first time that the machine has been used, and I need to do a little bit further configuration before I can get started. So I'll click on Start, and it will take me through about half a dozen steps to get the thing up and running. The first of which is to configure networking. Bear in mind that this is initial configuration, and if I make a mistake or change my mind, or I don't really want to do any configuration at the moment, I can always come back a little bit later and do this. So the thing's got two built-in Ethernet interfaces. A normal physical machine would have four, one of which I configured in the early stages of the configuration, which you saw earlier. Okay. So there's nothing to change here, really, other than I might want to make these things a little bit less anonymous. For example, here I've got my data link, which is my physical link, and here I've got my interface, which is the link but with the IP address assigned, etc. Okay. So imagine I wanted to edit this. If you point to the object, can you see there's a trash can symbol, so I could remove the information, or there's a little pen which I could click on to make changes to edit. And I'm going to call this, the name of the host is Hokey, and I'm going to call it Hokey data link, because I'm going to use that interface as a published interface for people to access the shares on this device, and reserve the other one for management purposes. Okay. Notice while we're on this form that I can actually use it to create link aggregations, and a link aggregation is a fairly sophisticated mechanism for failover and load spreading. So I can combine a number of Ethernet interfaces into one apparent physical interface. Okay. And lack P aggregation then would ask me, if I clicked on that, to enter some information about the link aggregation. Lack P is link aggregation control protocol. And once the aggregation is up and running, the protocol will be used to inform the switch that a link aggregation exists, and hopefully the switch will configure itself accordingly. It is worth noting that you need something like a layer 3 switch, or certainly a network switch that supports link aggregations, yeah. Which I don't want to do. All I need to do is change the data. Notice I can also set up a VLAN. My interface also, I'll just tidy that up a little bit. I'll call it hooky data IF. And at this layer of the protocol, note I can use IP multipathing if I want to. Multipathing is not quite sophisticated as link aggregations, but it's a very well used technology in Solaris, and it provides failover and a certain degree of network load spreading. Yeah. At the moment, I don't want to use that, so I'll bypass it. Just change the name. Once I've completed the step, just click on commit. I didn't apply, so it's warning me. Now it wants to know my DNS domain, which I actually already put in at the early configuration stage, you might remember. Then it wants to know NTP, which is Network Time Protocol. So I can give it some machine names or IP addresses to go and look at to configure a Network Time Protocol, which is very important for a system like this to make sure, you know, if it's a storage device, then the timestamps, etc., on the files that you're recording are absolutely correct. I'm going to use some local ones here. It's always best to have two or three of these machines. Two will do us today. The more the merrier, really, because the system will go after each of these machines and work out you know, a time that it can deduce from both of them. We'll sync our clock, and then we'll commit. If there's any problem contacting these systems, we'll get an error. So this will validate the fact that it can access the NTP servers while we're actually doing it, so I'm keeping my fingers crossed here. Now, it wants to know name services, because I could be storing user account details on some remote server. I may already have a number of user accounts set up, and I can choose a variety of different name services. A name service is basically a store of administration information, perhaps IP names and addresses, which would typically be DNS, or usernames, passwords, IDs, group names, passwords, IDs, and a whole variety of other administration that would be very useful to store centrally. Okay. Quite a common one these days is Active Directory, which is a Microsoft mechanism. And so this appliance can authenticate through, you know, if you as a user try and access a share on here, then this system can go off to an Active Directory box and say, is this a valid user? Okay. We don't want any of these things at the moment. Okay. Now we have to configure the actual hardware. You'll see a number of screens as you use this software. You'll see things like available pools with a plus, and you click on the plus and you can start adding things. Okay. So we have to give the ZFS pool a name, and the pool will be an area of space that is given to us by assigning a number of disks to it. So it's like a sort of logical volume, if you like, and I'm going to call it some pool name. I'll use Superior, which is a well-known very large pool in North America, and obviously a good description of the product. So the two things go well together. Okay. I've got 15 disks on this appliance. Okay. Remember, it's a virtual appliance, so the capacity is actually quite small, but for demo purposes, it's quite good. I might create a pool using all the disks, depending on how I'm going to configure them shortly, or I could create different pools for different systems to use. Obviously, if you're interested in making sure the management is simple, then just create a single pool. So I'll choose a number of disks fairly randomly. Obviously, you'd normally think about this a bit, and commit to it. Excuse me. Okay, this screen is asking me for the disk storage I've selected, what type of data profile do I want to use? Do I want it mirrored, single parity RAID, double parity RAID, striped, which doesn't give us any redundancy, but very high performance, or triple mirrored? Yeah, and you can see the characteristics over here. Availability would be the redundancy, so you know, triple mirrored would be very high availability, as with double parity RAID. Mirrored also provides good redundancy, and also very good performance. Okay. There is obviously some thought required to work out exactly, you know, for the workload you've got, what would be the most suitable. But, you know, I don't want to spend too much time looking at these things now, because I'm more interested in showing you the general purpose facilities of the device. Okay, so I'm going to choose mirrored. Commit. Okay, and there's the summary of my data profile with my single pool.
Mick, to this pool notion, there is a question in the queue about, should everything go in a single pool? Does it have to be in a single pool?
No, you can have as many as you like, Dave. It's just administratively, it works out to be easier if you have a single pool, because then you have a totally transparent amount of space, and within that space you can add individual shares. You can create different projects. So really, you don't need more than one pool. Unless you want to have a completely different type of data profile, you know, from one type of server to another. But usually speaking, you just have a single pool.
Perfect. Thanks, Mick.
Okay. The GUI is now allowing us to register online, which we don't need to do at the moment.